tribe, and my stories will thrive. Welcome to another video by the Blue Tongues of Hell for some more HYLDR Chronicles. This 21st chapter is called The Garden of Idunn. The late summer sun was as high as it would ever get, its pale face hid behind a veil of ash and could not pierce through the sheets of mist clinging to the island since the early morning. A scent of burning bark sailed over the plains with a northern breeze that could not dislodge the thickening mist. Under the dire circumstances, Esmond praised many and Sol for once in his life and galloped north with the rising sun to his right. Kyoko held on as well as she could with her frail arms around Esmond's waist. Her neck was sore and her back stung every time she exhaled. Clouds of flies pestered the riders. Deer flies, horse flies, and irritating small ones that the island had never seen before went for their eyes, ears, and nostrils. Phantom snakes of blood-sucking insects chased after Kyoko's wounds. And the lucky few who reached her tender skin dipped their proboscises into her bleeding scars and met little resistance. The route to the grove was a treacherous one. Esmond knew that hordes of the undead were in their way. Earthquakes had disfigured the uneven plains, and they could fall to their deaths at any moment. The unnatural mist only made that fate more feasible. Further west, an army of enraged Hellheimers and Draugs marched together on vigrant plains for the injustice of the king's son's kidnapping by a traitor from Vanaheim. They were ready to fight as one to defeat the undead. Hellheimer's warriors didn't paint their faces white as the moon this time. They were grimed in black charcoal paste from head to toe to resist the poisonous mist and expunge the curse of Nebelwood's underworld. Nevermore would they be ripped from their graves, from the glory of battle. Moving forwards, with little resistance either, other than tall grass and sharp thorny trees, the warriors noticed a mortuary sound of many types of birds singing afar. The blended songs chilled their blood and grew louder as they marched further into the mist. A few flocks of passerines dived into the Norsemen and flapped lamely at their boots with broken wings and visible skeletons. A peregrine falcon with one eye swooped out of the ashen haze and aimed for Refer's neck. The Draug hadn't lost his swift agility and sliced the undead bird to a cloud of feathers. He spun a curved green saber in his left hand and finished it off. King Hedi led the troops through the mist. He held in his right hand a long lance with a three-spiked head that shone like moonlit silver. One of the treasures from the Nibelungen Mountains. A group of undead soldiers from mixed realms bumped into his horse and dug their teeth into its brown stone coat. Hedil jumped off his ride and swung the lance ferociously. One of the undead lost its distorted face that shriveled like hog's ears over a flame. He jabbed the others away from his horse and beat the biters into incandescent rotten meat. Harald called for pails of paste from one of the barrels that a dozen horse and carts were hauling through the fog. He had the undead doused in Gunnar's recipe and waited for the fragmented parts to twitch back to life. They did not. Harald exclaimed genuine excitement for the small victory, and roars of enthusiasm followed. The clatter of metal and cheering only attracted more waves of biters who were eager to taste the new medicine too. From above the lake of mist, bursting halos and soft explosions of light gave the battlefield the likeness of a lightning storm brewing in the distance. Through the mist, Asmund could see a glowing aurora tingling on the horizon. The woods were on fire. He could smell it. Kyoko could see something else bleeding turquoise and violet light through the grey soup. It was where the dragon had tried to kill her. She tugged Asmund's shoulder and grimaced as she told him, "Go left. Nabori is that way." He didn't reply and spurred his horse to ride faster. The ongoing battle to the west was helping their progression through the land of the undead. Hedil's army locked heads with the undead, who sorely outnumbered the living. The mist had not turned their fallen warriors against them, and black paste was keeping the undead from cheating death once minced to bits. But the enemy did not weaken. Icto Ixin's weapons had not prevented heavy casualties, although they had performed wonders in fending off the swarms and disintegrating many corpses to dust. The dead simply didn't stop attacking, and their ranks didn't appear to reduce the slightest. How could they tell in this murky mist? Harald had almost lost hope and thought of how he could escape through the maze of decaying flesh. His spear was powerful enough to bore holes into his enemies, who were inflicted internal incendiary damage. And he wouldn't have survived without it. But he couldn't foresee any positive outcome if the battle didn't end soon. Everyone was on edge, exhausted by terror of what would come next out of the mist. And the sound of birds from hell wouldn't stop. The Draugs cut through anything that wasn't painted black. Of course, many undead corpses had originally died in fires and were withered and grey as slate, which led to occasional errors of judgment and unfortunate beheaded Hellheimers. Kara had enjoyed the new life in Helheim amongst humans and felt a minor pang of regret when slicing through an ally's spine or chopping off an arm or leg by mistake. She hated the dark mixture she was made to smudge all over her body. It was like wearing an item from Gunnar's wardrobe where he kept his vials and potions. Therefore, every one of her victims wore the face of sadistic Gunnar, and cried out in pain with the voice of Kyoko. An aurochs ran into river and dragged him through herds of undead animals and men until the skeletal beast toppled forwards into a ditch. Steaming water ran along its bed, and plenty of other undead creatures awaited him in the mud. A legless, besotted woman with long, blonde hair crawled towards him, trailing organs behind her like peacock feathers. That was enough distraction for a huge black bear with burnt skin to savagely maul his back. A man with claws pounced over the bear and joined the fight, scraping Refer's chest to the bone. Refer rolled away and staggered to the other side of the ditch, crossing the puddle of steaming water that had nearly evaporated. The bear, the Draug, and the undead woman began to glow red, and the hair on the Refer's wounded shoulder blades suddenly sizzled. This time, Refer reacted swiftly and hopped out of the ditch, over a slow river of molten rock boring through the plains. The hot air divided the mist and shed some light on the extent of the enemy's numbers. But nobody was enraptured by the revelation. They were up against a sea of hellish subjects who would not run out of breath.
"We merely left the dent in their armor," said Harald to Hedil,
who was putting his legless horse out of its misery.
"Don't give up, Harald. Nidavellir depends on us."
Harald was shocked. This man had truly believed his words when he had dreamed up Nidavellir's united island. Harald used to have ideals. Then his uncle showed him the ugly nature of humanity and how to profit from it. Hedil and the rest of them were perhaps gullible, but they were brave enough to die for an idealistic lie that Harald had improvised one evening in the docks of Muspelheim.
"Have I lost my way?" "You mean it, don't you?"
said Harald, burning away an undead Draug's head.
"Of course, murky Lord Harald. Don't lose focus."
The battle had lasted all day, and the sun was already setting. Many Helheimers couldn't lift a finger to pull a bow and were ready to admit defeat. A bright metallic call pierced through the fighting, the moans and the sinister choir of birds, and a glimmer of hope shone through the mist. Hordes of the undead switched to the northern target to feast on that instead.
"The falcons got to Muspelheim in time,"
said Harald.
"Astrid has guided the Firebird's army to us." "That must have been a very convincing missive, Harald,"
replied Hedil, beating an undead corpse of a man stuck to the antlers of an elk. Muspelheim's iron horns blasted out once more, and Helheim's drummers gave their leather tambour skins another pounding. The cavalry smashed through the undead to Helheim's survivors and dragged another dozen cartloads of black paint to drown the dead in. Astrid rode up to Harald and lifted him up onto her black horse.
"Astrid, change of plans,"
he whispered into her ear.
We need to win this battle at all costs.
Astrid didn't hide her confusion, but she was glad that he was safe. You redirect the reinforcements then, heading for Moon Castle, she whispered back and kissed his lips. She jumped off her ride and let Harald escape. Harald tossed her the deadly spear and disappeared into the phantasmagorical mist. Kara found King Hedil, who was now a Draug. She saw he was in harm's way, with claws jammed in an auroch's ribs on one side, while fencing on the other with the corpse of a flax farmer who still had an axe wedged in his brain. Kara tore that man in two and sliced his limbs off like she'd done all day, which had become the most tiring work she had ever done. Haste, she yelled, and the pot's contents was thrown over the undead victim. Freya forbid it rains tonight.
I didn't know you believed in the gods,
said Edil, yanking his arm to get the cloth out of the frantic aurochs. Just an expression. Switch to human. Hedil was too tired to fight anyway as a Draug and slithered back to his lightweight size. His hand slipped out of the beast's ribcage and he brought his lance down hard on the auroch's skull, sending it crashing onto the flint ground beneath the long grass. Hedil sighed and hacked the creature to warts of flesh and bone that Kara had painted in charcoal. King Hedil, said Kara close to his ear. We hear many things, do we not? The earth rumbled in shock as they faced the maw of the undead. I know as a fact that Harald was not attacked by Draugs in the Nibelungen Mountains. I also heard that this battalion of his that has come to save us is only a slice of his army heading for Helheim as we die here.
What? That slimy snake would do something like that on a day like this?
He's as crooked as a fish hook. Astrid was too busy eavesdropping the conversation and didn't see a Draug rush by. He left a deep cut in her waist and was gone. Hedil saw her fall and ran to her rescue. Another shadow Draug dug a claw into her neck and vanished into the mist. This girl does his bidding, said Kara, protecting Hedil as he tried to save his cousin. They poisoned your men and staged your father's death.
Enough, growled Hedil. We have a war to win.
Kara wasn't too worried what Helheim would become while they unleashed their fury against the undead. She nodded and picked up the never-ending fight. Before the sun was stabbed by the thrones of the gods, Asmund and Kyoko arrived at last in the small grove known for centuries as the Garden of Idunn. Torches were burning in a glade where large flat rocks formed a stage around a mossy floor. Hilda glided out of the shadows and greeted them in her black, feathered dress. Kyoko saw the red fox ghost, Ordur, and her companion, Girl, hiding behind oak trees, where lurked many other sordid creatures. Kyoko jumped off the horse and twisted her ankle. That didn't slow her down, and she hobbled towards Asmund's sister. My son! Give him back to us! One thing after another, Kyoko. You must learn to be patient. When someone asks you to do something in exchange for, let's say, the well-being of one's own child, it is wise to accept the terms and not upset the kidnapper. Imagine what would happen if I didn't tell my slaves of eternal night not to harm Napori before you are put to bed underground. You wouldn't want that, and neither would I.
Sister, please, stop the madness.
Asmund, dear, we have no time for this. The moon will soon be here. Two undead giant draugs restrained Asmund and forced him to watch Hilda put on the Nibelungen gauntlet and pick up the great sword. Why won't it turn to gold, for hell's sake? Hilda walked up to Kyoko and touched her bottom lip. You don't look well, Kyoko. I've got just what you need. And Hilda ran the huge blade into Kyoko's chest. It cracked open and poured out a wave of blood. Hilda wasn't in the mood for torture and pulled the blade out. She gently swung the sword round and effortlessly sliced off Kyoko's head. There. Suits her better like that, doesn't it, Brodir? Hilda didn't bother replying to Asmund's insults and pointless threats and returned to the flat rock where she and Hedil had once conceived their child. Her eye sockets darkened and an acrid mist crept through the grove and carpeted the garden of Idunn like a wave of white fungi. Hilda bled from the eyes, and Kyoko's head shuddered. Kyoko's expression of horror faded to grief, and her head slithered back into place. Her ribs cracked into their original shape, and Kyoko's skin melted back to its soft, pale complexion. Even the infected claw marks on her back had gone.
Kyoko!
Kyoko gasped for air. Don't waste your breath, sister. Asmund will have to deal with you now. You have to be buried undead, remember? Or your Napori dies! Daijabu, Asmund. I have no regrets. I enjoyed these last years with you by the sea. Spend many more with Napori. And any maiden who makes your heart smile, like Nietzsche would have.
I can't, Kyoko.
Nearly dead,
said Ordor. You must, said Hilda, dragging the Pori out from behind a large boulder with a dagger to his throat. Hurry now, the moon is shy. Goodbye, Napori. Listen to your father. Especially at sea. I love you both so much. Asmund, get a move on, said Hilda, cutting in the buried skin. Goodbye, my love, said Kyoko. One of the giants dropped a rusty shovel before Asmund and kicked him forwards. He smelt the oxidized iron and closed his eyes as he thrust the old spade into the mossy ground. Dig, brother, dig! If you haven't buried her before the moon hides behind the trees, your son will have to watch his mother die for nothing. And he will have to watch both his parents perish a horrible death. Hilda wept a few tears of bile, and the sinister mist stroked the boy's hair. A lot worse will happen to you, Popori. Kyoko stepped into the shallow grave herself and lied down in the moist soil on her back. Asmund kissed her goodbye. Take good care of him, or else, Kyoko said, and a gust of wind blew out several torches. Asmund felt a chill run through him, and he struggled to get out of the grave. Shoveling warm earth over his wife was harder than he thought it would be. She stared up at him without blinking, and his heart fluttered. He could feel the warmth from the woods and the dark brown peat, but a ghostly breeze of icy breath froze his skin and gave him goosebumps. Who was this woman, really? He knew that fishing her out of the sea might curse his ship, but he did it anyway. That's what mermaids do. Enchant men at sea and wait for them to crash their boats on lilac rocks. Asmund thought of Nabori, of Pekar, and the daughter he never had, and shoveled a heavy load of soil over Kyoko's haunting gaze. He accelerated the digging rhythm to muffle the spluttering and coughing on the ground, and gasped in horror when his own shadow appeared over Kyoko's grave. The full moon was out, and the mist had gone. When Asmund had finished sprinkling dark earth over his wife and had successfully buried her according to Hilda's desires, Nabori fell to Hilda's feet asleep.
I don't understand when you became so evil. What have you done to Nabori?
He is with Nott, dreaming of his late mother.
You'll regret this night, sister.
Hilda stepped down from the slab of stone and strolled towards Asmund over the fresh soil, profaning Kyoko's grave. My dear Brodir, tell me, have you never escaped your powerful body? She asked, ordering her undead draugs to keep him still, and gone for a gallop through the woods at night, and woken up naked on carpets of dewy moss, unable to recall how you got there. No? Dear, you are to me, and to everyone else here, in fact, said Hilda, showing him a few onlookers, shaped as rooks, squirrels, and wrens. She felt his remaining arms, biceps, and smiled. Half, Brodir, let me tell you about our Modir while we wait. As you know, we share the same Modir, a doe, a Huldra, Skegold of Nebblewood. What you may not know is that your father, the same one who tried his best to kill me twice, raped our dear Modir, who'd only just been with my own father, Freya. Yes, the horse. I love to gallop like my Fuddy through the woods and feel the morning dew trickle off my naked body. I'm sure you would, too. Asmund had been fed many lies during his short lifetime. His sister had mastered the art of deception and veiling the truth, and he still couldn't see through the mist of her intricate schemes. Was Kyoko even really Edil's secret lover? Were Asmund's children not really his? If that was written in the stars, then should he also believe that he was a woodland creature like his mother and sister? Or did Asmund try to kill his wife because his sister played him like a fiddle? Asmund fell onto the fresh soil of Kyoko's grave and cried. He hadn't done so since his beloved father had done something so disturbing in the forge of Nibelungen that it had brought him to tears and urged him to murder his own father. Oh, Asmund, it pains me to see you suffer so. Imagining how satisfied the enchantress was in my husband's arms. It used to be such a thrill to be loved by that man who father despised so much. Did you know I found out that Hedil was also my brodir? I killed myself when I found out. Yes. After murdering Hedil's real mother, Skuld. I must be undead by now. I've died so many times, you wouldn't believe me. Asmund pretended not to listen, with his head buried in the peat. In the end, dear Brodir, I didn't care, and still chose to be with Hedil. Blood wasn't important. Hilda licked a metal finger on the gauntlet. Maybe you should have been the one to mount me on this slab. Or cut me open like a sow. Drink my blood and chew my unborn child under the moon. You should take me now, Brodir. While the witch's blood is still warm. It would take my mind off what I will become tonight.
Silence, Hilda!
Asmund stood up uncomfortably. All that sweat lost for nothing, and no trophy to show for your sweet dedication to your sweet sister, born only a few blinks before you. We must have been so close in Modir's slippery womb, in a wet pink bed together, for hundreds of moons.
Hildur, stop!
You grew so fast, my dear Brodir. I could never catch up.
I loved you, Hildur. I always did. Your troubled heart was perfectly normal. How could we pretend that everything was fine when Fadir thought it wise to drop his daughter into a well of lava or into the icy waves? And yet we did, and lied to ourselves until nothing made sense. And you hated my wife for some profound reason. She threatened you somehow? Did you think she would drive me away from you? That I wouldn't be there when you needed me? In that case, why did you have me sent out to sea? Was I in the way of your ascension to the throne? You see the lack of logic there, my dear sister. I never wanted anything to do with power plays to crush people who shouldn't be our enemies.
Asmund, your soul is so pure. Now I see why I used to think that way. You are the emblem of our house's coat of arms. The mighty green elk born to lead Vanaheim towards greener pastures. Your Vadir believed it too. Ironically, you were destined to rule. You soar through this hideous war between the realms for what it was, and you were right. We were fighting for nothing. Our blind goal to unite the three divine relics was as pathetic as my obsession to remain human, drinking limonosia from Nepalwood's breast every day to stay near the throne and one day claim it for my own. Even Ogni's gauntlet was a counterfeit, and so was I. The war, my illicit relationship with the enemy, the rivalry with a ghostly foreigner, all was my sick way of getting back at Ogni, of making everyone pay for Modir's death. Modir should not have died like that. I would have done anything to punish the person responsible for her demise. And I was told by an old dragon that one day I might be able to, on a full moon, in the garden of Idunn. I have buried my undead enemy, and I wouldn't have been able to do it without you, Brodir. I wouldn't be alive without you.
Without you, Hildr, I would be living a happy life with Kyoko and our three kids. Without you, our sick father might still be alive, and I would have forced him to put an end to the war. The burning woods wouldn't smell of rot. The plains wouldn't be purulent scars of the past, festering with death and sorrow. The future wouldn't be like drinking poison and bleeding it out of every pore before placing one step in front of the other. Take your blade of gold, Hilda,
said Asmund, kneeling before his sister with his head low.
Raise it high and send me back to Modir. Your only Modir is darkness.
Hilda spat at her brother and waved off the undead Draugs. She wanted to erase everything in her sight. The poisoned woods, the shattered island, the bloody sea and growling mountains, the flaming sun and frozen moon. All needed to be wiped out for good so she could start again, like dewdrops dripping from her naked body on a chilly morn. Hilda felt the cold dew. Her skin was wet again, like it was on the firecrest when the fine surf soaked her dress as she stood at the bow to guide the Drakkar forwards. She was a siren again, floating over the waves, higher than anyone else, destined for greatness. A stag's antlers dug through Hildr's ribs and heart. the heart that had been forever mended by the Order of the Mist, by the wells and the lords of hell. Her face blossomed with beatitude like the roses of blood, flowering around Asmund's antlers as he carried his dead sister above him. Dark blood poured from her eyes and breasts, and a sea of mist flooded the island again. The sap of the ash tree dripped into Asmund's eyes as he carried Hilda out of the blazing forest, along a red burning river, to rest where Skiggle was once buried. See you next time for chapter 22 of the HYLDR CHRONICLES. Take care.